Hey, Taryn and Donna, it's Bruce, Melinda, and Oscar at Haydocy Airstream and RV. We're standing here beside your beautiful piece of jewelry, your new little 16-foot Bambi Sport Airstream. So we're going to do a quick walk through for you, walk around, show you how everything works, get it posted on YouTube so you'll know everything you're doing when it arrives. And I want you to please call me if you have any questions on any of these things. You've got my cell number, you know how to get a hold of me, and I'll remind you at the end too. But we're going to start here at the door, work around the way, the outside here, and make sure we cover everything, and then we'll do the same thing inside. And normally at this point, I'd say if you have questions, interrupt me. You can try. I don't think it'll help much, but we'll go through all these things. It's going to be a bit of a monologue, so it's going to be a little quicker than it normally might be. But again, after you've watched it, watch it two or three times. Take some notes if you've got questions, and then call me, and we'll talk about them. We'll make sure you guys are ready to rock and roll. So Taryn and Donna, let's get started. We're standing right here by the door of the Airstream, so let's start with the door. First off, we don't need a sold sign on here anymore, so I'm gonna hand it to Melinda. Everybody knows now it belongs to Taryn and Donna. So the Airstream door, when you open it, actually latches back. It latches to the side of the trailer so the wind can't catch it and whip it around on you. It's real easy to unlatch. I do it with one hand. Just slide that over with your thumb. You can see how it works there. Just be a little gentle with it when you put it back, but that holds it in place. The screen door on the Airstream latches to the main door with this little trigger-like thing right here. And that actually doubles as the latch for your screen door over here. When we push it shut, you'll see it latches in place. And when you're inside, that slides over. So if you're inside wanting to get out, you're gonna use this little grab here, slide it over, pull this loose, and your screen door is open. When you're ready to put it back in place over here, just push it back in there and it's latched. Now there are two locks on an Airstream door. This is the lock to the latch. Now I've got two sets of keys for you. This latch key right here is this small one with the black latch is this lock. The deadbolt is the big one with the black, okay? Now I always caution everybody, Airstreams are not like any other travel trailer out there. Every other travel trailer on this lot I can open with my master key. Cannot open an Airstream with a master key. They're all individually keyed. So word of caution, you're going to get two sets of keys. But if you pull this lever and you shut the door, it's going to lock. Don't ever, ever do that unless you're absolutely sure you have your keys in your pocket or your purse. If you don't, if you lock your keys in here, you're not getting in unless you call Airstream or a locksmith. And that's going to take a bit. So just remember to do that. In fact, a lot of people like to get in the habit of just shutting the door and locking it with a key for that very reason. This deadbolt also gives you security when you're inside. You can lock the deadbolt to secure yourself inside. Now, when we're going down the road with ours, I lock them both just to be extra secure. So that's all there is to the door. I do want to point one thing out behind the door, just because I'm afraid if I don't now, I'll forget it when it comes back around. And that's your outdoor shower here. Everything on the outside of this unit will open with this little round silver key right here, and it has a number on it, CH751. The only thing on the outside of the unit that will not open with that is the locked compartment on the back, which opens with this little round silver key. It looks identical, except it has a different number, RS141. So kind of keep that in mind. 751's gonna open this one. These locks are all a little tight when they're new, so just be stern with it. And basically, you can see this is just a pass-through. So the shower that's in there on the gooseneck kind of hose, you can actually bring out here. And that way you can give the dog a bath, you can rinse the sand off your feet. If you've got muddy feet, you've been hiking, you can rinse them off. If you're out in the middle of nowhere, want to get one with nature, you can do that too. So that's all there is to the outdoor shower. And I'll explain to you how everything works inside when we get in there as soon as I get this locked. There we go. So back to the door. We're going to move right on around. I'm going to show you the step here real quick. The step is a piece of cake. It's pretty much a two-handed job, only because if you try to do it with one hand, unless you're really good, you're going to get it kind of whopper-jawed and won't go in. I'll show you what I mean. Because I do this and I get it crossways and it doesn't want to go. Two hands makes it very easy. Just lift up, put your fingers underneath, lift up on the back, and lift it in, and it's latched in place. It's up and out of the way. To pull it out, same thing. Just pull up, put it down. That's all there is to it. There are a couple of rookie mistakes, okay? You don't have to worry. There are actually three on some trailers. There's only two on this one. One is driving away and forgetting to put your step up, catching on something, you tear it off. One of the other mistakes you don't have to worry about is cranking an antenna down. People have crank up antennas, they tear them off on tree branches when they don't put them down. This has a real nice omnidirectional antenna that you don't have to crank up or down, so you don't have to worry about that one. The other issue is your stabilizer jacks. Now, I laid a crank out here that actually is going to store in your storage compartment in the back, but I wanted it handy for the video. And this is the crank for your stabilizer jack. There are four of them, and a key thing here is what they're called. They're called stabilizer jacks, not leveling jacks. They are not designed to lift, and we in the industry have kind of caused that problem because sometimes we call them leveling jacks. That's not what they are. When you are leveling your travel trailer, if you see that you have a low side when you're backing in, you're going to put some blocks or some Legos, leveling blocks, that kind of thing, on the side that you think you're low. You're going to estimate, I need an inch or two, you're going to back up on it, and you're going to level it. Now, when I talk to you tomorrow, Taryn, about the list of things that you need, one of the things I'm going to point out is called an Anderson Leveler, which is a very, very easy product to use. We've got it. It makes this process easier. Basically, you just put it behind the tire, you back up until you're level, and you stop. Now, that's how you level side to side. Once you're level side to side, you chalk your wheels, then you unhitch. Don't unhitch until you've chalked your wheels and leveled side to side. But once you've done that, you unhitch. Then you're going to level front to rear with this tongue jack up here. You're going to raise or lower until you're level front to rear. Now, we have levels. You can get the stick on the outside. I personally don't like the looks of them. I use a 6-inch carpenter's level, just lay it on the floor. But once you've got it leveled, side to side and front to rear, then you put these stabilizer jacks down. And you just put a little bit of pressure on them. They're just to stabilize it so that when you're moving around inside, it doesn't bounce. So let me show you how they work. Let me locate where it is here. Okay, let's put that in. Wow, I did it with one hand. I'm surprised. By the way, this jack has two slots in the end here. And the end of the shaft that cranks it down on the jack has two ears. Now, you don't have to line them up. You just get this on there and start cranking. It will engage. So I'm just going to put this in here. Right here on the end, I start cranking, and you can see that going down, and that's the leveling jack. There's one on each corner. This one's a little tight because of the step. The others don't have a step to deal with, but once you get it down where you want it, I'm just being slow so I don't make a lot of racket. Once you get it down, you're just going to put a little bit of pressure on it, and you're done. Do it the same way on all four sides. As long as you do an equal amount of pressure, you'll still be level. When you move around inside, the trailer won't be bouncing. It'll feel nice and solid. So that's all there is to the stabilizer jacks. Now I'm going to crank this one back up so I don't forget about it. Because remember, that's a rookie mistake. You put a stabilizer jack down, especially, I always warn customers, do not ever put a stabilizer jack down when you're hitched up. I like to go places when we're traveling. I like to travel at night. And sometimes we'll be traveling along, it's time to stop for the night. We'll just pull into a campground or wherever we can park for the night, crawl in and go to bed. Don't even unhitch. Don't even bother to level. Just find a reasonably level spot so we're not rolling out of bed. But don't ever do that and put a stabilizer jack down, because that's when you're in the real danger the next morning of coming out. You're already hitched up, you jump in your vehicle, drive away, and forget those jacks and it'll tear them off. So don't ever do that. Now, we're going to come back to the awning. This is the last thing we'll do outside. These are Lexan rock guards. These windows here in the corners do not open. However, this does open so that you can clean behind it if you want to. And it's not something you have to do very often. But I'm going to open this center protector here, this rock guard, which also doubles as a window awning for you. Just tighten these little screws up. Either way. There we go. And then we can open that window from inside. And I'm going to leave that open so I can show you how that window opens, because that window is different than any other window on this unit. But to take this, to swing this open, to clean behind it, you'll note that it's hinged back here. There are two what appear to be Phillips screws here. They are not screws. They are actually have little T things on them. So you put a Phillips screwdriver in there, turn it a quarter of a turn, and it's kind of just going into a keyhole. Once you've turned it a quarter of a turn, it'll pop loose and you can swing that out clean behind it. It's the kind of thing you might do once a year. When you're ready to put it back, you simply line that up with the slots, put it in there, turn it a quarter turn the opposite way, and latch it in place. That's all there is to it. when we close this, there's a little trick I'll show you on these little bungees that hold it down too, because they can be a bit of a challenge. You see, when you pull them tight, they kind of go right through your fingers. So there's a trick I'll show you with those. Your spare tire is right underneath here, right up front. If you ever need it, it's real easy to get out. All you have to do is pull this little pin right here and take this pin out. Spare tire is still not going to come down. This metal piece up here is what's holding it up. So once I've got that pin out, I can grab this right here, put my thumb here, lift, pull that back, and then lower it down, and the tire will slide out. One thing you need to be aware of, depending on the terrain, the thickness of the tire may not allow it to slide out very easily if the front of the trailer happens to be low. If that's the case, simply use the tongue jack, raise the front of the trailer up so you have enough clearance to get the tire out. Okay? We have a brand new Interstate Group 24 deep cycle battery here. And right here is the ZAMP solar plug-in. If you recall, we talked about they're all pre-wired for ZAMP, for solar. And it's just a matter of plugging it in. We have those in all kinds of wattages. For this unit, I'd probably recommend a 120, which means it's a portable unit that will fold up into a suitcase about 3 inches thick, about 24 by 36. You simply park your Airstream in the shade, put your solar out here in the sun, it has about a 20-foot cord on it, plug it in, it is truly plug and play, and you rock and roll. You can be out in the Bureau of Land Management lands off the grid somewhere with no power, excuse me, and you'll run out of water and food before you run out of power. Now realize, solar will not run your television, will not run your microwave, and it will not run the AC, but it'll run everything else. So you still have your cooktop, which is propane. You still have your refrigerator at that point, would be running on propane. You can run your hot water heater on propane. So you've got the comforts of home, just not all the luxuries. So these are your propane tanks. This lid opens up with a little latch back here. It's kind of different. It's got a kind of secondary latch on it. This pulls down, but before I can pull it down, I have to lift up on this little thing right here. So lift up, pull back, and you can see how it works. These are your propane tanks, two 20-pound tanks. I'm going to leave one open because we're going to light some stuff. And I'm going to leave this open so I remember that that's open, and I'll close it when we're done. These will automatically switch, but I always recommend to my customers that unless you're out in the dead of winter and you know one's low, just open one. That way, if I've got this one open and I run out of propane, I have to walk out here and close that one and open this one, but I now know that that one's empty and I need to go get some propane. If I have it set to automatically switch and I run out, I'm completely out. They're both empty and I'm out of luck. Now, like I said, the only time I might recommend you open them both, if you're out doing some winter camping, you've got the furnace running at night, you know this one's about to go out, and you don't want to get up in the middle of the night and switch them, go ahead and open them both up. Just remember, you've got one to go fill. At this point, I'd normally say, do you have any questions? Jot them down and call me. Moving on around this side. In fact, you know, since you're not here to hitch up, I'm going to talk about some things here that I usually talk about a little later. These are just your safety chains. These are going to hook on your hitch. A lot of states require you cross them. Ohio doesn't, but a lot do. By the way, if they're too long, here's a neat little trick. Just twist them. Kind of like the old rubber band, it shortens them up so they're not dragging the ground. Obviously, you don't want them too short, but you also don't want them dragging. The tongue latch, like that's latched there, and so when it's dropped down on the ball and I push this down, it's now secure. But when you put this on your vehicle and you've lowered it on and you've latched it, I want to caution you to do something. I want you then to crank it up. And I want you to crank it up enough that you find that you're actually lifting your vehicle a little bit. That's just proving to yourself that this actually did latch and the latch isn't sitting on top of the ball. We've all heard stories about people going down the road and their trailer comes unhitched. That's why. You need to make sure it's latched, and that's the easy way to do it. When you go to unlatch this unit, it's a little different. You don't get to just pull up on this. You have to push forward towards your vehicle. Push forward and then up. Now it's unlatched. Okay? And then this is an emergency breakaway cable. This is something you want to hook to your vehicle, and the way I usually do it, since it's a long cable, you certainly don't want it dragging. Feed it through a chain a couple of times and then hook it to that same hook. But what this is for, if this would ever break loose from your vehicle going down the road, this is going to pull this pin right here, which automatically engages the brakes on the trailer so that it doesn't run over you or somebody else. Now, I got to tell you, if that happens, it's not going to be pretty, but it'll keep you safe. So make sure you've always got that hooked up. And again, you don't want it to drag, because if it were to drag and catch on something, it would pull that pin and set the brakes in the trailer, and you're going to wonder why it's getting so hard to pull. Moving on around here, right down here you've got a propane valve. That is closed, the little valve being sideways. If I turned that valve to be in line with the fixture, it would be open. This comes with a 3-foot hose. It's a quick disconnect, just like an air hose if you've ever been around one of those. But it gives you the ability to set a gas grill here and hook it up, or maybe get a propane powered generator and run it off of propane so you don't have to haul gasoline with you. And what that does is it's plumbed right to these propane tanks. So it takes propane right out of your tanks, which is awesome. By the way, one thing I failed to mention, these are 20-pound tanks. They're brand new tanks. If I'm you, I need propane, I'm gonna get them filled. But if I'm in a jam and I don't have anywhere to go get them filled, I would exchange one. You can exchange those at Lowe's or a lot of places like that. They're the exact same tank that your gas grill takes at home. So that's a nice convenience. Moving on around. This is your water fill. This is going to open with your 751 key. Remember, it opens everything except the locked compartment. And this is where you fill your water tank. And you're just going to fill it with a hose. Now, as you're filling this, sometimes you might get a little airlock, and you'll think it's full, and you'll stop, you'll hear it gurgle a little bit, and then it'll take some more. I always fill mine until it just flat out won't take any more, and I take the hose away and it's gushing more out. That way, I end up with 100% for the first 2 or 3 days before it even drops. I probably have 120% in my tank because I'm filling the lines too. This is a water vent here, and when you close it, when you put this cap on after you've overfilled it like I'm suggesting, water is going to continue to run out of that vent for a little bit. You'll close this, you'll see water dripping out of here, but that's fine. Doesn't hurt a thing. And when we go inside, you'll be seeing the monitor panel, which lets you check your battery level. It tells you how much fresh water you've got in your tank percentage-wise, and of course your sewer tank as well. So that's all that is. These are actually refrigerator vents. Now, I could open these and show them to you. I'm not going to, and I'm going to tell you why. If you ever do need to get in there, they're basically just vents or for service to get in there. But if you ever do need to get in there, you stick a coin in this, turn it vertical, the bottom will pop out, and you can get in there. The reason I'm not going to pop it open is the number one call we get from customers that pull their new trailer home is they get home and they say, hey, my refrigerator vent door's gone. And the reason is they look in there and they don't get it latched properly. And so it's not really latched, the wind catches it and it flies out. So I'm gonna leave those in, they're nice and secure right now. That's all they are, they're really just for service and ventilation. Here we have a city water connection. City water connection is a little different than filling the water tank. This is when you go to a campground that has water where you can hook up. Sometimes they have full hookups, sometimes there'll be places that just have water. You're simply gonna hook a water hose to this, and then you have an endless supply of water. Now this bypasses the fresh water tank, and you do not need to use the water pump. So when you're using this, don't turn your water pump on, and I'll show you that switch inside. But you've already got pressurized water. That's why we call it city water. A lot of places you go, a lot of campgrounds will have warnings, and some places, even some KOAs, will say you're not allowed to hook up to water unless you have a water pressure regulator. I've even gotten calls from customers at KOAs. They won't let me hook up because I don't have a water pressure regulator. All Airstreams have a water pressure regulator built in. It's right behind us in the wall. Most KOA owners will know that, but once in a while we get a phone call and we have to tell them, yeah, it's okay, let them hook up. So you're safe. Doesn't matter if they've got 70 PSI, 80 PSI water, you're good. Go ahead and hook up. You don't need to worry about it. This next fixture right below it here is what we call a black tank flush. Now, I think you're aware, on the 16-foot Sport, you don't have what we call a black tank. You have a combo tank. So your gray water and your black water both go in the same tank. But this still serves the same purpose. Back in the day, before they came up with these black tank flush systems, and all Airstreams have them, they're optional on some units, but a lot of companies don't use them. You used to have to take a wand and stick it down in the toilet with a valve open and rinse that tank out, and you got stuff blowing back in your face. It wasn't pleasant. It wasn't fun. But these tanks have high-pressure nozzles built into them. So, and this is not something you need to do every time. But if you're using your toilet in here and there's some solids in it, they can settle. So once in a while, you want to hook a water hose up to this while you're at the dump station. Have your valves open that I'm going to show you here in just a second, and you're going to let this run for a bit, and those high pressure nozzles are going to rinse that tank out. So if there's any solids that have settled in there, they're going to flush them out. It's an awesome, awesome setup. It's real simple to use. You really don't do anything except hook up and make sure your valve's open. That's all there is to it. Your dump station is right back here. I'm going to get to it in just a moment. Right now we're going to talk about the hot water heater. And hot water heater is pretty cool. There's really no need for you to get in here other than service. I'm going to take this paper out of here because you don't need the paper in there. And it's all winterized already. That's why this plug is just sitting in here, because you requested that's where that goes right there. Everything is winterized. I don't have any water in this system. It's all depressurized and got potable antifreeze in it. So you're good for the winter. But I wanted you to know what this is. If you ever need to get in here, I suppose one thing that you could do if you ever needed to, you're in a jam, this is a thermocouple right here. That's user replaceable. But most of the time, this is just for the service guys, and you don't even have to come out here to light it. It's all controlled from inside, so I'm going to show you how that works as well. This is your furnace. Obviously, it's not meant for either one of us to get into. This is just a service panel, but be aware that this is an exhaust, and when the furnace is running, that will get hot, and it'll put out some warm exhaust. Now we're down to the dump station. Down here, we have one valve, and right here we have a light switch, and you see the little LED. It's not real bright, but at night if you're having to dump, it's plenty bright. It just doesn't look bright in the daylight. But if you've never dumped, it's real easy to do. You simply take this cap off here, and it's tight because there's an O-ring in there, but you can see these edges. It's a bayonet kind of mount, and there's these posts on the side. So when you put it on, you're going to put it up, just line it up and give it a good twist so those tabs are completely engaged. Now your sewer hose goes on the same way. So when you put your sewer hose on, you take that off, you put the sewer hose on. The sewer hose has an elbow on the other end, and you're going to put it in the dump station. Once you've got that all in place, you're going to pull this valve right here. And it's a guillotine valve. I'm not going to pull it right now, but it comes out about 3 inches. And basically what it does, if this is the inside of the pipe, it's kind of doing this. It's just kind of a gateway. And so when you pull that, then you're going to see you'll hear all the stuff rushing through the pipe. And my old knees won't take this too long, so I'm going to stand up. You'll hear all the stuff rushing through the pipe. And the sewer hose I'm going to recommend has a clear elbow on the end as well, so you can actually see what's going on. When it's all done, what I want you to do, some dump stations are up on an island, which means it's raised up. They aren't all. But even when they're not, sometimes you have a low point in your hose. So don't disconnect the hose yet. Grab your hose, walk it over to the dump. That way, if there's anything in that hose, you're walking it out. Once that's done, close your valve. Take your hose off. Most dump stations have water there. It's not potable water, but they have water to rinse your hose off with. And put your cap back on, put your hose away, and you're done. Some people like to wear latex gloves for that. People ask me about it, I say, hey, my hands are washed, I'm not worried about it. So it's really a pretty clean process. If you have any questions on that, give me a shout. Now right here, this is your 30 amp connection. Now the cord, as you can see, is polarized. There's one L shape here. The cord plugs in and turns about a quarter of an inch clockwise and locks in place. When it locks in place, there's a collar, if you want, that you can screw on here. I don't always do that. If I'm going to be somewhere for an extended period of time, I do. But you simply put that in there, turn it a quarter inch clockwise to lock it in place, plug it in the other end, you've got juice in the Airstream. To take it off, it's exactly the reverse. This down here is a cable or satellite connection. So again, if you're at a resort type RV park, a KOA, someplace like that, a lot of them offer cable or satellite. You need to have your own little RG58 cable with you, and maybe take a 10 footer or something, put it in there, just keep it. But when you're somewhere like that, you hook up to that. You can change the antenna feed on your TV, go to source and change it, and you can watch cable or satellite. So that's pretty cool. Moving on around, Not much to talk about back here. Oh, wait a minute. We got all this storage space. Now, this is where the RS-141 key fits. Okay, to open these, just pull out and turn, and there it is. And you've got all kinds of Sterilite tubs in here. This come with it. And this is accessible from inside as well. I'll show you that. Now, this is where you want to store your sewer hose. But in the Bambi, you don't have a bumper here. So what I'm going to suggest you do, get yourself a nice heavy plastic bag after you've rinsed it up, off, coil it up, tie the bag off, stick in the corner here. That way you don't have any issues with odors or anything like that. This is really nice. This is one of my favorite features of the 16. When those are locked, be careful because you can try to tear your fingernails off trying to get that open. When it comes to you, it'll have a 45-day temporary tag on here. I think we already talked about that. Ohio's a little bit slow with their title work. You'll see it in about 4 weeks or so, but that'll give you plenty of time to go to your BMV or whatever Maine calls it and get your plates and get them transferred. This right up here is your rear view camera. Now, it's wireless, and since you don't have your tow vehicle here, I'm not going to be able to tell you a lot about it, except that when you plug it in to the cigarette lighter in your tow vehicle, it's going to have power. You hit the power button, and it's wireless, so you don't even need to do anything. But I want you to be aware that this rear view camera gets its power from these clearance lights. You should never be towing without your clearance lights on anyway. So when you turn your clearance lights on, that'll have power. You'll get an image inside on the screen. It's great for while you're going down the highway. It lets you see about three lanes of traffic behind you. It's also great for when you're backing into a campsite. When you get to that point, when you've got your tow vehicle and you're hooking up, if you got any questions on that rear view camera, call me and I'll just talk you through it. Now, let's talk about the awning. But I need this tool right here. And honestly, I'm not very good with this tool because I don't use it very much. I can reach most of this stuff, but I'm going to use it so you see how it works. Because there's a latch right here and here that we have to undo before I can pull that awning out. Now, what I want you to do when you're undoing this, I want you to always be pushing, not pulling. So if I'm going to unhook that, I'm going to put it down here. When I'm going to hook it, I'm going to put it here. So I'm pushing. If I'm pulling, I have the risk of this thing slipping out and then I scratch my trailer. Ask me how I know. Okay, so these can be a little tight. There, that one's unhooked. We'll go back here and unhook the other one. There we go. Now, this is also for folks that can't reach this. You can simply grab this right here. You pull it down to where you can reach it. Take this out of your hand, just throw it down. Now, I'm going to pull this down here, and I've got to hang on to this for a minute, okay? Because if I let go, it wants to go right back up. So I'm going to hang on to it. I'm going to take this off of this pin right here. This little hook right here goes on the axle. Now I'm going to do the same thing over here. Once I've done that, I can let go of this. Now I'm going to step out here, see if I can come down to this end and do this where Aaron can see me. And I'm going to grab this right here and pull it toward me. Now, I'm a big guy. If this is a little high for you, get yourself a step stool. But I want you to also cheat. I want you to realize that when you grab a hold of this, you can grab a hold of it and step into it a little bit. So you're leaning back and using your body weight. Just give it a little yank and you'll hear it latch. We'll do the same thing on the other end. And I'll come right back down there. And then when you go to raise this, I want you to be aware of something. This arm right here is a floating arm. And I've got to pull this pin right here. If I simply pull this pin, pull it out, and try to pull on this to go up, it binds. You can't hardly move it. So don't do that. What I want you to do, two fingers and thumb. Thumb here, two fingers here. Now I can pull that pin, and I can still allow that arm to float. I can just leave it in the middle. Then don't pull here. I want you to lift here. And when you lift here, it doesn't bind. It goes up very, very easily. That's all there is to it. You do the same thing on the other end. Now the awning's up. I simply come in here. I roll this up. I cheat and fold it a little bit. Then I roll it up. Stick it in the loop. Boom, we're done. Now, one thing out here I haven't talked about yet. You have a 110 outlet right here. Obviously, you have to be plugged in for it to work or have a generator. But that's where you're going to plug in anything that you want out here under the awning. That's where Karen and Donna, you're going to plug in party lights because you can plug them in right here run the cord up here to wrap it around, clip them all on the edge of the awning. That's all there is to it. Putting the awning away is just the reverse. So to put it away, I'm going to pull this loose so I can grab it when I need to. Now I'm going to pull this down, and remember, you don't want to bind it here either, because see what happens if I'm binding it, it won't go down. I've got to let it relax, just let it free float. When I get close to the last hole, just let go and it will engage. And if you can hang here, Aaron, I'll do the other one, be right back. Okay, now I'm going to step under the awning, grab this, and I'm going to pull this pin. Now, I'm going to hang on to this because I got to take that off the axle, and I'm going to put it right here on the inside. Hey, Oscar, what you doing, buddy?
He's been playing ball.
Is he playing ball? Got a mouthful. Now I'm going to pull this one here, do the same thing, take it off, put it right down here. And see, I'm holding this down now. So I walk out here, let it go up. Now when I run out of reach, I grab my little tool down here. I'm gonna cheat. Just let it go back up. That's all there is to it. Now I've gotta hook those again. So I'm gonna grab the tool so you see how I hook it. Again, we're gonna push. I'm looking right into the sun, I don't know if I can see it or not. Okay, now see how they don't line up? So you're gonna pull down. That's why this has a hook on the end. So you can make it line up, and I can't see because of the sun. There we go, like that. And if you have trouble with this, again, get yourself a small step stool. By the way, you can cheat with this one because it's right here by the door. If you have too much trouble with it, step up on the step or even step in the door and grab a hold of the door frame, and you can reach this by hand. That's all there is to it. Most people, by the way, this is aluminum. It's very flexible. It will bend. Just straighten it back out. Most people store this, it's too long for the closet. In the 16 Sport, most people store this under the mattress. Slide it under the mattress, that's all there is to it. Okay, I think that's everything outside. So let's take a look inside. Maybe I can talk Melinda into handing me my drink over there so I can get a swallow. Excuse me just a second, guys. Get a little bit dry. Hard stuff, lemonade. Thank you, sweetheart. Okay, let's go inside. Now, if we're gonna start by the door and work our way around again, come on ahead and step in here. We've got some switches by the door right here. I'm gonna sneak right back in front of you. Sorry, I should have had you come in first. This one here is what did I just do? Hang on.
This light, is the power on?
I think it is. I'm not seeing which one it is. Bear with me, guys. Oh, you know what? Hang on. Nope. Hey, let me reach under here and make sure the master's turned on. That's one thing I'm going to show you. So I'll show you right now. This is the battery cutoff switch right underneath the dinette here. Reach it. There it is.
It says it's on.
They say on?
Off, on, yeah.
Okay. I'll tell you what, why don't you pause just a second and I'll plug in. Hi, Jared and Donna, this is Bruce. We're going to plug in here so we've got some power. Remember I talked about this being polarized. You can see the little L right there. So remember, I'm going to plug it in there. I'm going to shove it on. And I'm going to turn it about a quarter turn clockwise. Now I wanted to video this part so that you could see. Because Turner, we've talked about this adapter. This is the adapter you need so that you can plug this in at home. What I've got run out here, you and I talked just a few minutes ago about plugging into a regular extension cord. This does not go on the camper. It goes on the end of your 25 foot 30 amp cord. So I'm gonna put this on here, just like that, and then I can plug this into a standard outlet, like at home, or your extension cord. Then when we go inside, we'll have some juice. Bingo, we have lights. I'll let you step in first, Aaron. Okay, now we'll find out which switches are which. This one right here is your ceiling lights. Now your ceiling lights, Aaron, if you can aim up at one here, have a switch on them as well. So I just caution people, if somebody doesn't know any better and they're walking through here turning out lights and they turn out your ceiling lights, You come in and say, hey, something's wrong, my lights don't work. Check this switch up here. The reason they do that is you can dim it by actually having just one on instead of two if you'd like. Okay. This switch here is, let's look. This one right here, the outside one, is a step light that's right here by the step. So it just kind of lights the area out here. I just turned it off again. But that's what that outside one is. The inside one here, if I think if you look, is the bathroom. Is the bathroom light coming on and off?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so the middle one is the bathroom light. You can't put the switch in the bathroom because it's actually a wet bath. And I'll explain all that to you in just a moment. So there's your light switches. Up here is your stereo. Now I'm going to leave the stereo, the television, to you guys and your manuals. They're pretty standard fare. Realize that this does have Bluetooth. Here's a microphone right here. So if you guys are out and about and you want to make a group phone call and just sit and talk hands-free, you can do that. Also allows you to have an iPad or a smartphone or anything like that, an Android tablet, and stream some music. You can pull up Pandora and stream music through this as well. You do have CD player right there, and this is a USB charging station, so you can plug your smartphones in. There's another one back toward the back. Here's a remote for the sound system. Little trick about these little timbre doors, if you just pull them up, then it'll stay. But if you look at the sides, you'll actually see, and you won't be able to see in the video, but there's a little tiny notch. So if I pull up there and pull toward me, it catches in that notch. As soon as I push that, it's down. And they all work that way. Now, these can be a little bit tight sometimes in the beginning. They will loosen up with use. These are all pretty good, so you're in good shape. The curtains are dry clean only, okay? If you want to take them off at some point to get them dry cleaned, you can unsnap them here, take this screw out here, this linen cap comes off, top and bottom, and then you can slide them all the way out. Get them dry cleaned, slide them back in, put that piece in, put the screw back in, snap that in place, and boom, you're done. Now, I'm going to move this box. I'll show you everything in it here in just a moment. Because I want to show you something about the window and the curtains. The curtains, when you pull them around, just pull them around like this, and they're Velcro. There's more back here. You can come clear to the middle. They have Velcro, so you can fasten them together in the middle. But what a lot of people try to do to open them is this. And they're hard, and they get caught on the latches and everything else. It's kind of like pushing a rope. When you're ready to open it, grab it back here and pull. And it's much, much easier. Okay? Now, this window, I told you I'd show you how this window opens. These are latches. You're going to free them like that and turn them down. Once I've got that open, and this may be a two-man job for you, I've got long arms, you're going to lift these two pieces here, and there's notches outside that I'm going to shove those into. Can you get a shot of those, Aaron? See those notches right there through the screen? So there's actually three positions that you can have that window open. Nice thing about that window is it's a window, unless you're in a driving, blowing rain, you can have it open in the rain, which is kind of nice. This is your television remote, which I'll point out in a moment. But now I'm going to show you real quick how this bed goes down. This has a snap, so you can snap it into place. And actually somebody snapped that on the wrong snap. It goes on this one right here. Because this snaps here so that these don't move all over the place. But to make the bed, I'm going to take them out of the way. Just stand it right there. I guess I'll turn it that way. Here we go. I'm going to take this one out. It was snapped. The reason I'm doing that is I need to get these bottom cushions up out of the way to put the table down. By the way, you can see they're Velcroed down. A little bit of paper there. They're Velcroed so they don't slide out of the way. Now, when I put this down, there are two rubber feet on here. Can you get those, Aaron? Okay, those rubber feet are going to seat right inside of this. They don't sit on it, they sit inside it, so that the table goes down in the right spot. To lift the table, to put the table down, you can see those tabs back there. I'm going to lift up on the front until it comes out. And it swings down just like that. I pull down on this, put that up out of the way, put that in place. Now see, I moved it so that it dropped into place. Put these cushions back down. this cushion rips off of here. These come on, and these two smaller cushions go in the middle. That makes up your whole bed. These curved cushions on the back are not used. Now, sometimes people like to put this up like this, put the cushions in the middle, use these curved ones in the back, throw pillows up there, and use it as a chase, which is kind of nice. But that's all there is to it. Now, when you're putting this back up, word of caution. We're going to lift it up. I'm going to pull it toward me, line that up, those tabs up down there, and lower it so they go in. Don't ever, 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 ever let go of this table without putting that leg down. You'll rip those right out of the wall. So I'm just going to push that little latch, put the table down, boom, we're done. That's all there is to it. So now I'm going to put this back. I'm going to put this back. This one came from over here. I'll snap it in place. This one goes over here. I'll snap it in place. And we once again have a dinette. Okay, right underneath here, this I call this a pot and pan drawer. Just a nice big drawer. Put anything in you want, but looks to me like a good place for pots and pans. Now, that's the only storage under this one. Under this one over here are all mechanicals. There's a water tank under there. The cutoff switch is down here. I think I mentioned that earlier. That cutoff switch is exactly the same as if I went outside and took the positive lead off the battery. So, when you park the unit in storage, if it is not plugged in, you want to turn that to off. That disconnects everything so your battery can't discharge. But if you're parked in storage plugged in, leave it on, because if I have that disconnected, it cannot charge. When you're plugged in, it'll keep your battery charged for you. It'll also keep your battery charged for you while you're towing, so you want it on. The other reason you want it on while you're towing is because, remember the breakaway cable out there? You pull that pin, that cable gets pulled, it sets the brakes. It needs the battery to do that. So you need that on while you're towing. The other thing down here is a propane leak detector. It is green, so all is good. It's pretty terrible sounding. I won't make you listen to it. But it's down by the floor because propane is heavier than air. A couple of things can give you make it go off besides propane. If you use anything with an aerosol propellant, hairspray, room freshener, things like that, they can make it go off. The other thing that could make it go off besides propane is if your battery level were to drop below 10 volts. It will go off just before it quits working. So, if that thing goes off, and I'm going to show you where to check your battery voltage here in a moment. If that goes off, you check your battery voltage and it's 12 volts, and you've not sprayed or better, and you've not sprayed anything, just get the heck out of here. Don't take any chances. Get out, leave the door open, close your propane tank on the front, let it air out, then you can come in and check things out. If you've sprayed some propellant, or you check and your battery voltage is down near 10 volts and it's gone off, you know why. Don't worry about it. Just get plugged in or quit spraying the stuff. So, okay. Smoke detector or carbon monoxide. There's another one. They look identical. There's another one in the bedroom. That one back there, I believe, is smoke detector. This one's carbon monoxide, but I may have them backwards. They look identical. I'll talk about this box real quick, and then I'll leave it sit here on the table. It's a box of Airstream goodies. First off, here's like your window sticker. So you've got another one of those too, because I've got a briefcase of manuals and so on for you. Here's the 3-foot hose for that propane valve on the front. Remember I said it's quick disconnect? That's what that is. You can buy an extension. You can get up to 12 feet for those. Here's the monitor for your rear view camera. By the way, it has a suction cup mount inside that you can put it on the windshield if you want. A lot of people like to just put it on the console, but again, if you have questions on that, call me. Some things in there here you will never use. This, anything that came with the TV, they give you. This is a base for the TV in case you want to take it off and set it up somewhere. Years ago, when you bought a sewer hose, you didn't get ends. Now they all come with ends. Airstream still ships these as if you're buying sewer hoses without ends. If they quit shipping these, they'd probably save themselves $1 million a year. This is a mount for the shower head in the bathroom. Most people in the sport choose not to mount it. If you decide you want it mounted, call me. I'll give you some guidance. The reason most people choose not to mount it is they just lay it down in there. It's much handier and it's easier to fish out if you can get it from inside, outside when you're in, you know, and when it's inside. This is a faceplate and a couple of tools that goes with the stereo, because the stereo is actually an automotive stereo, and that faceplate actually comes off. You know how people used to in their cars, they take the faceplate off and put it in the glove box or something when they park. That's what that's for. So that's really all there is to this. You've already seen your stabilizer jack crank, and which is normally in here, and the awning tools outside. I'm going to put it under the mattress for you. So I'm just going to put this all back in here. This will ride very well under this table. That's where I'm going to put it. There we go. By the way, you got a 110 outlet under the table. You've also got another antenna outlet. If you ever do want to set another TV on the table or something, you can. Although your television in the bedroom is on a swing arm, so it comes out and you can see it here, and I'll show you how that works. Okay, still moving around in the same direction here. I don't want to skip anything, and that's kind of the way I keep myself organized. Microwave, you guys know more about microwaves than I ever will, so I'm not going to get into that. It's a nice microwave. It's telling us PF right now because I wasn't plugged in, and that means power failure. Here's your cooktop. Cooktop is pretty simple. Turn it to light, hold the button in to override the thermocouple, and hit light. Okay. Try the other one. Probably get air in the lines. There we go. That one lit. Come on. We did have air in the lines. Now this other one should light. There we go. So they both light. Then you just adjust the flame up or down, and of course you turn them off. Now that's the main reason right there. Well, a water heater too, that I left that tank open in front. I'm going to shut that off when we're done here. But I also want you to be, and I know Aaron was just shooting that, let this cool down before you close this glass lid. Okay. Your refrigerator. This is a two-way refrigerator. It's 110 or propane. So when you're going down the road, you're going to run it on propane, and that's perfectly fine. When you're plugged in, it's going to be running on 110. So why waste your propane if you got electric there? And there's a setting here where you can put it on auto, and if you've got it on, it will be running on propane, and you plug in, it will automatically switch. You unplug it, it'll automatically go back to propane, which is the way I run mine. And I'll show you how that works too. The way to open and close this thing, there's a safety latch on it. You're going to grab it here and press very, very firmly right here with your thumb to unlatch it. That's a safety catch so it doesn't pop open going down the road. Everything I'm going to tell you here in the next couple of minutes about how to run this refrigerator is right down here on this label. Okay, so if you have any questions, take a look at that, but don't be bashful, call me too. Okay, I'm going to lift this up to turn the fridge on. I'm going to press this button. Now it's on. Now it says check, and the check light just went out. That means it lit because it is currently on gas. Now, if it had not lit, that check light would stay on, indicating there's an issue. First thing I want to do is check and make sure I turn open my tank up front. If there's air in the lines, it could be stubborn. You might need to light your stove and pull that air out of the lines. But I like to leave mine with this button out. Now, I had it backwards. That's actually gas right there. And it did just light. I heard it. In, you can see the button out is gas. In is auto. Now, since I'm plugged in right now, it's running on electric. If I were to go out and unplug, it would automatically, seamlessly, and me being completely unaware, switch over to gas. It's a great system. The only thing I would caution you about, it's on the driver's side. When you're buying gas, turn it off before you pull into the gas station, because it might be right by a pump, and it's got a pilot light in there. If you're going down a highway that has tunnels, a lot of times you'll see no propane, no open flame. Pull over, shut it off. It'll stay cold for hours. Just next time you stop, turn it back on. That's all there is to it. So I'm going to turn it back off. That's all there is to the fridge. Okay, we've got a light right here over the sink for you. It's individually switched. Got one and two. By the way, we've got mini blinds. They're pretty standard fare. You know how those work. I'm going to leave those up there so they don't swing around. By the way, you can latch that blind down here too. You can see it right here where it goes. There's a GFCI outlet right there. This is cool. I can put this down now. Every outlet in this unit runs through that GFCI outlet. So if you have any issues, with your outlet, and I'll show you where to check it because the reset's not right there. It's in your converter box underneath. There's a GFCI in there, so if it trips, every outlet in here will quit working. So that's where you look. To open these other windows, and all the other windows in this little Airstream are the same. They're a great window. They're made by a company called Hair. This bottom just cranks open. It's real easy to do. Just crank it open. Again, you can keep them open in a rain. It's real nice. I'm not going to run this. You can see we have a little pink here. That's potable antifreeze. Some in the sink as well, because we've winterized it for you. But to run that, I would simply turn this pump on. And I can hear the pump run. There's no water in it, so it just continually runs. But it's a demand pump, just like if you lived in the country and had a well. So it'll pump up pressure, it'll shut off. You run water, the pressure drops, it kicks on, and it shuts off when you shut the water off. So you get where you're going, turn it on. And again, this is if you do not have a city water connection, because remember that city water connection bypasses all this. If you're hooked up to city water, don't turn this on, you've just got water all the time. Word of caution, if you've got city water and you do not have full hookups, remember you have an endless supply of water, but you don't have an endless supply or storage of wastewater. But if you've got full hookups, then that's a non-issue. Just be aware of that. Your monitor panel right here, if I press this button, shows me battery voltage. Right now it shows 13.3 because we're plugged in and it's charging. If it were not charging, it would read about 12.5. This is our fresh water tank level, which is zero because it's winterized. That reads in percentages, so it would go up to 100. Same with your, this one's going to say open, not used, because remember you have a combo tank. So the black tank shows 13%, and that's because they've got some antifreeze and stuff in it because they've been running it and testing it, that kind of thing. And then this is your pump switch. When it's on, it's green. It's off, it's not. That's all there is to that. Water heater, simply turn it on. That turns red because it's kind of a check light. When it goes out, it means it lit, and I can hear it burning right now. If it does not go out, again, it's a check light. It's an error light. Go check, make sure your tank is actually open, make sure you don't have air in the lines, and so on. You can also end up with air in the lines when you run out of propane and have to replace a bottle, so be aware of that. Little storage down here. One thing I will mention on the hinges, on all the hinges on these Airstreams, there's a little tab right on the back here, and I'm not going to pull it, but if you catch something on that tab, this hinge unsnaps from its base, and you'll think, oh my gosh, my door's broken. If that were to happen, you'd snap that little piece off right there. You can see where to line these up, and you press firmly, and it'll latch back in place. Took Melinda a couple of trips before she realized she needed to be careful about not catching something she's pulling out on that latch back there, because you can actually take that whole door off. Here's your silverware drawer. Really cool. Got a nice tray for you. A little storage down here, and this isn't real deep because we have a fender well behind it. And right here we have wardrobe. Nice wardrobe with a light, by the way. I like the way they do this because your hangers don't slide all over the place when you stop. Now, under here is your hot water heater. And this strap is so you can snap it up to access it, because there's a couple of valves there. You guys were talking about winterizing. Those are some valves you'll have to use when you're winterizing. I'm not the winterizing expert. When you get to that point, call us and we'll work with you and help you with that. Now, this light is an easy one to forget and leave on. That's why that's one reason too that battery cutoff switch is important. When you're parking this thing, you think, okay, I've got everything off. You walk out and you really don't. That battery cutoff switch will save your bacon, because it cuts off your battery and it doesn't die. Okay. While we're standing here, let's talk about these couple of things, because I tend to stand right under them and forget about them. This is your vent fan. Pretty good, neat fan. It's made by Fantastic. That's the brand. This particular unit is rated at almost 1,000 cubic feet of air per minute. I can feel air moving through here right now. I've got it on high. That's 3. There's 2. There's 1. And there's off. Now, when I crank it down, if it's on, I can leave it on and it will just shut itself off. That's all there is to it. There is a little knob right here. That's a 4-amp glass fuse. This is the old style glass fuse. You can buy them at auto stores, that kind of thing. If this ever doesn't work, that's the first thing to check right there. This is pretty standard fare. This is pretty much like running a window rattler that we like to call them. I'm not going to kick it on right now because I'm only plugged into 15 amp, and I know my 15 amp and will trip it. But you've got fan only, you've got cool, and over here you've got temperature. Toward the blue is cold, toward the warm, the red is warm, and this does have a heat strip in it. So it'll give you a tiny bit of heat without running the furnace. So if you've got a cool summer morning, this might be a good answer. These little side vents open, side and end vents open. So you can direct the air wherever you want, force it wherever you want in different amounts. This little thing right here is what we call a cold air dump. You can see these gates are closed. If I do this, they're open. So you walk in here and it's just blistering hot. Oh, turn it on and open that real quick. It just lets all the cold air dump right out and it'll cool down much quicker. Once you've got it cooled down, flip that over and adjust it the way you want it. So I'll trade air in places and I'll explain some stuff back here in the back. See if Eric can shoot around the corner here a little bit. Right here in the corner, you've got two sets of USB charging stations. So a place to plug in your cell phones at night, that kind of thing. And right here at each end of the bed, that is, they call it a hamper. You can use it for anything. There's one on each end. Pretty handy storage. Right here we have our thermostat. Now, that thermostat is, you can't set a temperature, you adjust to comfort, but it does have a thermometer on it. And this is where you adjust the temperature. And this is where you turn it on and off. And I want to caution you, the first time I ever turned one of these on, I thought I was breaking it. This switch is very tight. There, I just turned it on. And I just turned it back off. So don't be bashful with it. Here's your ceiling light switch right here. Again, there's a switch on the light itself. We have some lights back here for reading, that kind of thing. Storage overhead. This window back here works the same way, as do the curtains. All the bedding and pillows and everything come with it. Moving around this side over here, we've got a plug for the TV. The little green light there, that's the antenna amplifier. You always want that on when you're watching over-the-air channels or you won't get any. If you're plugged into cable or satellite, you want to push that little black button, turn that off, because it will actually interfere with your TV signal. The TV, there's a release on it here. That's what this strap is. Pull down, swing this out, and you can move the TV around. You can bring it out here to watch, like that. Now, if you look at how this works, you see how this latch works right here, so you know what you're doing. And this thing right here on the back of the TV is what slides over that and latches it in place. So when you're putting it back, just push it in there, be firm, and it'll latch. It's now latched. Ask me about if you're off the grid somewhere, you want to be able to watch Netflix, Yahoo, that kind of thing, Hulu, that kind of thing. Ask me about Chromecast. We can talk about that another time. Under here, furnace right over here. Nothing you need to do with it. You can see the two doors there. That's access to that same storage with those same bins we saw from the back. And over here on this side is your power converter. Just press on the top and it opens. That's where that GFI is. That's where some breakers are and some 12 volt fuses. There's a small fan in that you'll hear run occasionally when you're plugged in. It's very quiet, but you will hear it once in a while. And I hear Oscar. Just push it to shut it, it latches again. That's all there is to that. Bathroom, and we're coming down to home stretch. To open it, slide this to the rear and pull it open. That's all there is to it. We've got already got the light on in here. Let's start with this vent fan. Push up to open it. Press the red button to turn it on. Press the red button to turn it off. Pull it down to close. Got a nice medicine chest here. I don't know that you'll get a very good shot in there, but it's got some nice storage. You've got a clothesline here. That goes, I believe it goes straight over. Yeah, the keyhole for it is right here. You just put it in right there. And then you need to tighten this up so the line doesn't extend out further and you can hang things on it. When you want to put it away, you got to loosen that so that that'll retract. That's all there is to that. Now, I have people say, well, hey, my toilet paper is going to get wet. Yeah, it will, unless you put this shower curtain down. You've got a shower curtain on both sides. There's your window shade, a shower curtain here, shower curtain there. There's your shower head right here, and you can see all the pink in the commode. That's antifreeze. And shower head's pretty self-explanatory. This is a foot flush. When your water pump is on or you're hooked to city water, press that pump, that pedal part way down, it puts water in the bowl.
use the commode, press the pedal the remainder of the way down, and it flushes. And that's all there is to it. Now, the one thing I think we have not covered, by the way, you got some nice hooks here, some places to draw pictures, leave notes, fire extinguisher, but you also have a privacy curtain right here. Just unsnap this, pull this over, and it has a snap. Just help it follow the track there. You'll see it has a hole here and a snap here. Just slide it over and snap it in place. That's all there is to it. So now you've got some privacy, and notice that that includes the wardrobe, the bedroom, and the bathroom. So you've got everything you need. Gives you a little suite back there.
And the AC.
And the AC, yeah, yeah. So, golly guys, I think that's everything. Let me step over here. If you've got any questions, don't be bashful, give me a call. Melinda, Oscar, or I will be glad to answer them. Oscar probably has the best answers. But Taryn and Donna, we're just thrilled to death for you. We're really excited for you. Hope you have many, many years of enjoyment out of your new Airstream Sport. Call me anytime, 937-725-2433. That's my direct number. Call it daytime, evening, weekend. Anytime is good. You can call the dealership at 614-279-8880. Email me at bruce@haydocy.com or melinda@haydocy.com, and Oscar doesn't have any email. So, hey guys, love to meet you sometime. When you're out in your travels, you need to stop by and see us. And call
we
me.
We want
when,
pictures.
Yeah, we want pictures. We want pictures. Send us pictures of your trips. When you first get it, send me a picture of both of you standing beside it, and we'll be really anxious to hear from you. Thanks a lot, guys.